Good morning, Life Spring. This is the day that the Lord has made. We choose to rejoice and be glad in it. I'm so glad that we have a moment to worship today. Let's worship together. God, you're welcome in this place. God, we thank you for your love. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99, and I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give your love away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. We worship you, Lord. Thank you for winning over the love. Thank you for winning our love over and over again. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. We bow down before him, for he is Lord. Overcome the world through Christ Jesus. We celebrate our liberty today. And here's what we say. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Come on and help us say, oh, sing, great are I'm so excited about today. I'm so glad to be connected with you in worship. Stay tuned for a word, a powerful word from our pastors.
Well, good morning, LifeSpring. Wow, we are so honored and privileged to come into your homes today. Again and again, we say shout out to all of you in small groups today. Wow, man, we have so many connect groups going on right now and during this week. We just honor each and every one of you connect group leaders who are opening up your homes and getting things ready. We just love you and value you. So happy that you guys are getting connected and we believe growing as a result of what you're involved with today. God is forming you and shaping you, and it's so good to fellowship with believers. Let's get right into the message today. I believe that God is going to give us a word that is not just going to bless us individually and let us have a great little life, but I believe that on this word, this is a direction. This is like a compass pointing our community northward. And I want to talk to you today about what I'm going to talk to you today about. So go with me in the scriptures to John chapter 1, verses 12 through 13. This is what it said concerning Jesus. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. I want to talk to you today from the subject, birthright. Birthright. Now, see if you find yourself in this analogy that I'll be sharing with you. In the body of Christ, in the church, there is a spirit running around in the church, and this spirit is everywhere. It's a spirit called the orphan spirit. Now, the Bible clearly tells us over and over and over again that you and I are children of God. In fact, in our text that we read this morning, it says that because we believe in Jesus, he has given us the right. Other translation says he has given us the privilege, or we understand he has given us the access to be a child of God. And so if you believe in Christ today, this morning, you are a child of God. Now, I know this is maybe going in one ear out the other. You're saying, I learned this when I was 7 years old in my Bible class. No. Listen now. I'm going to lay something down to you today. We are called by God, set free from Christ's blood to be a child of God. Can you imagine being a child of God? It's the best thing you could ever be. Is a child of God. Yet while we are supposed to be children of God, there is a spirit running around in the body of Christ. And this spirit opposes the spirit of sonship. This spirit stands in opposition to sons and daughters of the Most High God. This spirit is called what they call the orphaned spirit. Have you ever heard of this? The orphaned spirit. The orphan spirit wants to attach itself to the body of Christ, to the sons and daughters of Christ. And you know if you have the orphan spirit, if no matter what you do, you never feel accepted. The orphan spirit will never let you feel fully secure. The orphan spirit brings with it many insecurities. Have you ever felt this? Oftentimes, a person who has an orphan spirit inside of them are always trying to prove to others that they are valuable. The orphan spirit says, look at my watch, look at my car, look at my house. If it's got shine on it, must mean that I'm shining. The orphan spirit does not allow a person to be fully secure no matter what they drive, no matter what school they go to. The orphan spirit will never let you rest easy at night because you will always be trying to prove to others that you're all right, that you're more than enough. The thing about this is that you can never get enough accolades. You can never get enough awards. You can never make enough money to satisfy and to quench the orphan spirit. Now, there are many reasons how an orphan spirit can enter into someone's heart and life. A lot of times it comes from our upbringing. If something's happened to us, if we've been cut down in any way, this thing tries to get into your life when you're early, and it tries to manifest itself as you grow up. So generational curses, hardness, sharpness, all kinds of things that will try to push themselves onto you when you're young can make you feel that you're not enough. And no matter how many sermons you hear, no matter how much of your Bible you read, unless that spirit is dealt with, you always have an orphan spirit. But I've come to announce today that you are called to be a son of God, a daughter of the Most High God. When that word says He's given us the right to be sons and daughters of God, what that means, it means that He's given you access to come to God. I think about a football player. If a football player has children, oftentimes you'll see these young children going into the locker rooms of some big NFL stadiums. And sometimes you'll see clips on the media, or you'll see Instagram little snippets of children going up to their favorite football player, and they get their little hat signed or their football signed, and they're just in awe. Well, the reason why they can get access to that locker room is because their daddy is a wide receiver or a quarterback or a lineman. But if they were not of the same blood, oh, I want to talk about the blood of Jesus. If they were not of the same blood, they would never have access to those things. And I'm here to announce today, because of the blood of Jesus and what God has paid for you, you now have access as a son or daughter of God to everything that is God's. That means as a son or daughter of God, I have peace in my life. I don't have to prove anything to anybody. I can rest easy because the peace and the purity, the righteousness, the healings, the miracles, all that God has is mine. And I'm just trying to preach to a few people today to let you know that you don't have to be insecure. You don't have to walk around trying to prove your worth. You cannot do enough to make God love you more. And when you and I, we become sons and daughters, not that we become sons and daughters of God, but as you and I begin to walk as sons and daughters of God, oh, the difference that will make not only in your life, but the difference that'll make in the world. You know, the world right now, it doesn't need any more church members. A couple of weeks ago, I shared this thought that we don't need more church members. We need our people to walk as sons and as daughters of God. I believe that if we walked as a son and daughter of God, I believe racial reconciliation and inequality would vanish, because we wouldn't just look at a color. We would say, that is my brother. That is my sister that these things are happening to. I'm telling you today, sons and daughters of God band together as one brotherhood, as one blood, as Acts 17 says, it will solve the problems. When you operate this way, I don't see single moms running in lack, because we don't just say, oh, that's a statistic. We say, that's my sister out there, and that's in my family, and we'll reach out and grab people and touch people. I'm looking for some people who will rise up to be a son and a daughter of God. Benson's commentary on this verse says this: to be a son and daughter of God means to stand related to Him, not merely as subjects to their king or servants to their master, but as children to their father, being taken under His peculiar protection, direction, and care, being favored with liberty of access to Him. The quote that I think our community needs to center around is that we need to move beyond being church people to being people who walk as sons and daughters of the Most High God. So today I want to give you five things a son or daughter is in the kingdom of God. We're going to run through these things today. These are five things. You got to get these in their spirit. Number one, the first thing about a son or daughter is that they are born into it. Oh boy, I'm going to preach today. The first thing about a person in Christ is that they are born into it. Now, John chapter 3 is a famous passage of scripture. Nicodemus, who was a Pharisee, comes to Jesus at night and he says, Jesus, he knocks on his door, Jesus. Now he was a Pharisee, Nicodemus was, all right? So he had the coat of all the religion you could possibly have. Yet he had all the religion you could possibly get as a Pharisee. He was not in the kingdom yet. Isn't that amazing? You see, you could go to church your whole little life and still be outside of the church. You could go to church your whole life and not be in the church. Joyce Meyer says, you could sit in a garage all day long, but it still will not make you a car. The only way that you enter into this kingdom is that you are born into it. Nicodemus asked Jesus, how do I come into the kingdom? He says, you must be born again. That's how you come into the kingdom, through the birth canal of the Holy Spirit. The other way you get in, it's the same line, it's that you are adopted into it. We understand that we're born into the family of God, and we're also in the same way, and we're adopted. We move from darkness and into light. We're adopted into this thing. Galatians 4:5 says this, but when the right time came, God sent his son, born of a woman, subject to the law. God sent him to buy freedom for those who were slaves to the law, right here, so that he could adopt us as his very own children. Now imagine, some people in our community perhaps maybe have adopted somebody. Now imagine if a family went out and they spent a lot of money and they took this child, whether a newborn or a toddler or a teenager, and they paid the money and they said, I want you. I grab my hand into that house and I pull you out and you are now my son or daughter and I'm adopted you. You are in my family. Now imagine if that young person, that young child, looked in some way at themselves as less than. Imagine if they said, no, this family doesn't really love me. No, I don't really have access to all the things in the refrigerator. No, I cannot jump on the trampoline in the backyard. No, I cannot go on the family vacation. I'm just not worthy. That would be crazy, but oftentimes that happens in the body of Christ. There's many people that although they have been adopted and brought into the family of God for whatever reason, they still feel outside the family. But I want to tell you today that God wants to take that orphan spirit and wipe it away and raise you up into the person that he's called to be. You have to understand that you're born into this thing. No one can take you out, no matter what you do or don't do, and you're adopted into it. That's the first thing. The second thing is that they relate to God as their father. They relate to God as their father. Jesus says, when you want to pray, he says, don't summon a king. Don't call a master. Don't go get an ambassador. When you want to pray, all you have to do is say what? Our Father who art in heaven. This is the way that Jesus teaches us to approach our dad. Now, my daughter, her name is Sally. And when she comes to me, she doesn't do a protocol. She doesn't wash her hands or wash her feet. Or she doesn't make sure that her hair is right. When she wakes up in the morning, she wipes out the goo of her eyes. She's walking down the hallway and she snuggles up into the bed with her little pink PJs on. And she snuggles up and she whispers in my ear, hey, daddy. Hey, daddy. She knows that she has complete access to me no matter what she did. If I whooped her tail the day before, she's coming up in that bed. Because why? Our Father. This is how you need to be approaching God. Our Father. Two things about responding to God in this way. Number one is that it's pure. When you come to God this way, you recognize that God is your dad. You don't need any protocol to get to your dad. Now, maybe in your earthly father you did, but in your heavenly father you don't. It's pure. Mark 14:36, Jesus called out, Abba, Father. It's the Greek word here. Abba, Father. It's the literal translation, Daddy God. This is what our great warrior King Jesus, how he related to God. He called out to God, Abba, Father. It'd be the same thing as Sally saying, Daddy. It's the purest form of relationship that you can have with God. This is what you need to be walking in. You don't need to strive. You don't need to serve 20 hours at the church. You don't need to give $50,000. You just got to come to God with the purity. Daddy God. Do you relate to God this way? The other thing about it is that it's natural. It's natural to do that. Galatians 4:6 says that our spirit calls out from within us, Abba, Father. So in other words, like this, when you get saved, however you came to Christ, you came up to the altar, you were crying, you were snotting, you were all this, and the Spirit came into you, that Spirit that came to you when you got saved, now the natural response is to cry out, Daddy God, Daddy God, Daddy God. But somehow, for a lot of people, that natural spirit, that innocence that wants to cry out, Daddy God, now gets stifled. It says, no, you got to pray in tongues for 10 minutes before you can get to God. No, I have to do this. I have to do that. But it should be completely natural for us to want to cry out, Daddy God. And if you're having a struggle with this, think about it this way. The same way you view God is oftentimes the same way you feel about yourself. That's a true statement. The same way that you view God is oftentimes connected to the same way that you view yourself. And so sometimes if we feel that we're not worthy, it will be hard for us to feel worthy unto an almighty God. But I want to tell you today, and this is not just one message that I'm speaking to you today. I just want to say for a second, I am so happy and honored and thankful and count it as an incredible privilege to pastor this church, LifeSpring, to pastor the precious sheep that God has given this sheepfold. Because we are going somewhere now, I'm telling you. We are going north. And the direction that we're going is to become the true church of Jesus. I'm not interested in a great building with smoke and lights. Although if God gives it to us or we build it one day, it'll be all right. But what I'm interested in is you becoming a, not becoming because you already are, but you realizing that you are a son, that you are a daughter of God, that you are born into this thing. No one can take you away, and no amount of achievement can make you any greater. You're born into it. And secondly, that you relate to God as Daddy God. Now, the third thing about someone who operates in this way is that they relate to others as brothers and sisters. They relate to others as brothers and sisters. They don't relate to others as Democrats or Republicans. Oh, boy, I was trying to be good today. I know. They don't relate to others as this side of the fence or that side of the fence. They don't relate to others and cancel them out because they said one post on Facebook. They recognize that others are their brother and of as their sister. You know, in my family, we all vote differently. In my family, in my five-person family, we vote differently, but you know what? We can't wait to see each other at Thanksgiving. We love each other. We understand that we got the same blood running through our veins, and no little political agenda or assignment can stop our love to one another, because that's my literal brother. That's my mom. That's my dad. And all through the New Testament, we talk about the family of God. And so to be a son and daughter of God, you rise above anything that the culture is trying to bring separation to us, because you know that we've got the same blood running through our veins as well. It's the blood of his dear son, Jesus, figuratively, of course. John 5:2, Jesus says to love one another. This word love is what we've been harping on. It's the agape love. It's the God love. How many of you know that if you love one another, you won't be having erotic love where you're lusting after your sister? Lord, this ain't somewhere. This is the kingdom. This ain't some crazy state somewhere. This is the kingdom of God. If we understand that we agape you, I don't do the pragmatic love where I'm just loving you to get me somewhere and I'll be nice to you so I can help you get somewhere, together we get somewhere. It's not a pragmatic love. It's not an eros love or an erotic love. It's the agape love. The Church of Jesus Christ, LifeSpring in particular, I'm talking to. We have to rise above and let love be supreme. Because if we love one another, we'll embrace. If I love you and you're a different race, I can embrace you. I can stand up and fight with you. I can listen to you and understand you and help bring healing to you in whatever way is necessary. Because I love you. Jesus says you must love one another. Now check this out in Revelation as he was talking to one of the churches, Ephesus. Jesus says this to Ephesus. He says, I know all the things you do. I've seen your hard work and your patient endurance. I know that you don't tolerate evil people. You have examined the claims of those who say they are apostles but are not. You have discovered that they are liars. You have patiently suffered for me without quitting. My goodness, the powerful church. But I have this complaint against you. You don't love me or each other as you did at first. Wow. The church at Ephesus was a powerful church. They stood up against evil. They patiently endured. Yet the complaint they had was they didn't love God. They got into works and they didn't love each other. Friend, we have to understand that as we are in the body of Christ today, the highest form that I could do today is to be a person of love as a son and as a daughter. And you out there, you are my brother and you are my sister. And so everything else doesn't matter because those are the things that matter. And I know that we're connected and are connecting in that way. You matter to me. The fourth thing about a son or daughter in the kingdom of God is that they walk in the inheritance. They walk in the inheritances. Now, I've had some opportunity to work with those in drug addiction. If there's anybody watching this today, please, I hope you understand that I would never cast a rock, because people who battle with drug addiction, wow, they have so much against them. You know, you might see someone who's a drug addict and cast them away, but if you get to hear their story, it paints a different picture. But the thing about a person who is in addiction, oftentimes, they do not get to enjoy the inheritance of the family. They don't get to drive mom and dad's car. They oftentimes don't even come around at Thanksgiving. They can't enjoy the turkey dressing on the table. And in some extreme cases, they're not even in the will. Because of the road of destruction, because of the path that they're on, they are not able to enjoy the blessing and the inheritance that is theirs. And the same thing is true for a son or daughter of God. While it's not about works, there is a blessing when I honor God. There is an inheritance to be shared when I follow the plan, purpose, and path that God has for me. That's why it's so vitally important for you to walk in holiness. You say, well, I'm a son or daughter of God. God's going to forgive me. Yeah, but you're going to have some consequences. When we talk about walking in holiness, Galatians 5:16 says, walk in the Spirit and you will not fulfill the desires of the flesh. Because the desires of the flesh bring destruction. And so if you're going to be a true son or daughter of God the way that you want to be, it's important that you follow God in the holiness that He has for you. That's why it's important for those of you out there right now, I'm just going to go in today, if you're sleeping around, whether with your boyfriend or girlfriend, or you're promiscuously messing around in things that you shouldn't, I'm here to tell you today that there are consequences that you will walk into. But if you walk as a son or daughter of God, trying to please your Father from the heart of love, not from a checklist, but from a heart of love, I'm telling you, there is an inheritance of blessings for you to walk in. So you've got to get your spirit and actions right, but you also got to get your mind right. Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says, do not conform anymore to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you might know what is the will of God for your life. It's important that you adjust your mind and spirit to the will and pattern of God so that you can walk in the purpose of God. Sometimes people walk in the dark not knowing their purpose because they're walking in darkness. Let me talk today. But if you walk in the light, understanding that God has all things for you and you're continually following Him, there is an inheritance that you can walk in. And sons and daughters enjoy the inheritance. It's like the prodigal son. He said, give me my inheritance now. He slapped his father, grabbed his money, and went out and spent all his money, the Bible says, on wild living. After being in the club and being in the strip club and being whatever, he found himself in a big old pile of pig slop eating what the pigs eat. You ever been there in your life today? But it all started because he tried to grab the inheritance that he thought was his instead of receiving all that God had to bring him. God wants to bring you good things today. And your ability to walk in holiness and have your mind renewed according to the will of God will allow those things to flesh themselves out in your life. And the fifth thing about a son or daughter of God in the kingdom is that they promote the family business. A son or daughter of God promotes the family business. Jesus said when he was just a little boy, when he got lost and they found him in the house of God, they said, son, where have you been? He said, shouldn't you know that I would be about my father's business? Oh, I wished I had 10 people that could be sold out to the call of God on their life. I wished I had 10 people that would say, sign me up for the Lord's army. I'm ready to promote not my agenda, but God's agenda. I'm ready to promote and live for not even a little church, but I'm ready to promote and live for the kingdom of God. I'm here to promote my family's business, my father's business. I got business cards. I've got manuals. I've got word of mouth because this family, this business is the best business in town. I like to eat sometime at restaurants, and if I find a good place, I'll be texting everybody. Yo, you got to check this place out. This is where you want to be. You got to. When I first found out about iPick Movie Theater, of course, they're not open now because of this pandemic. When I first found out about iPick, I don't know if you've ever been in the iPick. I'm telling you, if you need a good date, you need to go to iPick. It's a movie theater. They stretch out. They give you popcorn. They give you a pillow in the movie theater. It's the best thing ever. Boy, when I found out about that, I was promoting it everywhere. I was putting my pictures up there. And even on the time hop, it came up 3 years later. I was like, y'all got to try this out. Boy, I better be promoting the kingdom of God better than I promoted iPick. They're closed down and the kingdom of God is still going. Come on, somebody. I'm talking to somebody who will promote the kingdom of God. Jesus said this in John chapter 12, 49. He says, I do not speak on my own authority, but I only speak what the Father commands me to speak. You know, this is the thing. If I speak only what God speaks, then I don't have an opinion on gay marriage. I preach what God says about gay marriage. When I want to promote the God's business, I don't handle my finances the way I want to handle my finances. I'm going in today. If it was up to me, I'd take all my money and spend it on Joanna, all of it. But I handle my money the way God says to honor it, which is to not overextend myself, which is to honor the Lord with the tithe, be generous, and don't be servant to the lender. I handle my money. I operate my relationships according to God because I don't have an agenda. I'm here to promote my life with the kingdom of God. And so, LifeSpring, I want to tell you today, we are going on a direction today. I felt like I gave a pep rally, rallying cry to you today. Where are we going? We're headed north. And the direction that we're going as a community is not to be a church with a bunch of bells and whistles, not to be a church with an agenda on what we want to see. What we're trying to achieve and become is just brothers and sisters, sons and daughters who sit at the family dinner table, listening to hear what Abba, Daddy, Father says, and yet we're willing to run and accomplish all that God has for us because His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Would you come on this journey with me today? I believe that God has so much for you. And if you feel in any way that an orphan spirit has tries to creep up in your heart, I want to encourage you to not feel bad about it, but to recognize it. God wants you to be like a little girl or little boy who can come up into his parents' bed and say, Daddy, what are we going to do today? This is what God has for you. Let me pray for you today. God, I just thank you for each person here on this call. Lord, I thank you that you're doing a great work in their life. And I just declare that they are becoming the person that you've called them to be so that they might do what you've called them to do. I just declare for any person who feels they have an orphan spirit, we just come against that spirit. and let true spiritual sonship come into their life. Let it fill their mind. Let them know that they are accepted. Let them know that they are enough. They are more than enough who they are because of who their Maker is. And if there's anybody here who you need to accept Christ, would you accept Christ in your heart right now? Would you just open up your spirit, open up your mind to receive Christ maybe for the first time? All you have to do is say, Father, forgive me for my sins. Come into my life. Be the Lord and Father of my life. Say, I receive you now. If you did that, that you just open up the door to the Holy Spirit. And we just want to walk this road with you. You don't have to walk this road alone. We've got a family in the community that wants to walk with you. We've got some 5 small groups meeting this week. We just want to welcome you into our family, the family of God. Reach out to us on the group chat. Send us an email. We want to connect with you. Hello@lifespringmail.org. Listen, we love you, LifeSpring. Check out these couple videos, and we'll see you so soon. God bless you. As you've probably known, we've been doing online services since March. It's been such a long time. And we also know that online services are amazing, and they are equipping, and they are strengthening for you. But the truth is, there is nothing like an in-person and live service gathered together with the other saints. We also understand because of the virus, gatherings like this have been prohibited and hindered in many different ways. But our heart is to gather safely because we understand that you need it and that we need it together. And there's something so powerful when the church gathers together physically to lift up the name of the Lord and being strengthened by each other and by His presence. We've been looking for a way to do this safely, and an opportunity has arisen for us. And this is what we're going to be doing. Next Sunday, August 2nd, we're going to be renting out Grace Chapel on Sunday nights. 5:00 will be our service. We want to invite you to come. We're going to do it safely. We're going to have masks available for every single person. Hand sanitizing stations. We'll be wiping down the building before and after, and we'll be social distancing in our seating. And so we're going to make all the measures for you to have a safe place to gather physically. We'll have childcare, we'll have worship, preaching, and most importantly, connection with His Spirit and each other. So we want to invite you next Sunday, Grace Chapel. It won't be the same without you. If you feel safe, we're providing a safe place for you. God bless you, and we'll see you so soon.
Hey, LifeSpring family. We are so happy that we get to worship Jesus together. There's so many different ways that we worship the Lord. We worship through singing, we worship through the study of His Word, and we also worship through giving. You can give your tithes and your offerings simply and securely through the LifeSpring website at golifespring.church. There's 2 different options. You can click to either get the address and send in a check by mail, or you can just give securely online. We're so thankful for you. We're thankful for your partnership in the gospel as we make Jesus known here in our community. Thank you, and have a great day.